Hey, film fans. Throughout this series, I've made reference to the year 1967 as the beginning of New Hollywood. And in particular, I've talked about two films, Bonnie and Clyde and The Graduate. Also, however, I've cautioned against the notion that we can pinpoint the beginning of an era and say, oh, it started on January 1st of this year, or oh, it started with the release of this film. However, those two films do make sense. They changed the way audiences thought about the potential for American cinema. They changed the way future filmmakers thought about the potential for American cinema. And they changed the way the studios thought about the production, marketing, and distribution of American films. So even though there were precursors to Bonnie and Clyde and The Graduate, which I've talked about in other films, those two make sense as the beginning of this era. In fact, if one wanted to really be precise in pinpointing a moment when New Hollywood kicked off, you could look at this scene. It's gonna get bloody.
Hey, isn't that Malcolm there?
Fantastic, right? There's a lot about that scene that makes it work. The cinematography, there's several different camera angles, filming simultaneously, filming at different speeds, filming with different film stock. The performances are amazing, like it looks like they're just flopping about, but Faye Dunaway had to be tied to the car, they're acting their death, they're gazing at each other just before they die. There's so much going on in that scene that builds on their prior performances throughout the film. And of course, just the concept of director Arthur Penn to come up with filming the scene that way. But what really makes it work, and what makes a lot of Bonnie and Clyde work, is the editing. In this case, by Dede Allen. Another thing I've mentioned in this series is that I'm not 100% comfortable with the framing of New Hollywood as an era of creative genius directors. There was so much going on in that era beyond just the movie brass deciding they were going to change Hollywood. There was an explosion of behind-the-camera talent. So much talent that it would be impossible to consider it all in a short video. In this episode, I want to discuss editors, cinematographers, and production designers as we continue to consider the rise and fall of New Hollywood. I've already mentioned the editing of Bonnie and Clyde when I talked about the jump cuts in the introduction to this series, but it's hard to overemphasize how powerful, how important the editing of that film is. The film scholar Karen Perlman argues that that last scene, the shootout, works in part because of Allen's precise editing style throughout the film, that the film's actually preparing us through its unconventional choices for that explosive ending that relies so much on the editing. But Bonnie and Clyde wasn't the only film of 1967 to kick off the era, and Sam Osteen's editing on The Graduate is just as important to that film's success.
Thank you. and streams are ripe and swelled with rain. May she will stay, resting in my arms again. June, she'll change her tune. In restless walk, she'll prowl the night. July, and give no warning to her flight. August, die she must. The autumn winds blow chilly and cold. September, a love once new has now grown old.
Ben, what are you doing?
Well, I would say that I'm just drifting here in the pool.
Why?
Well, it's very comfortable just to drift here.
That seems kind of easy to mock these days because that montage editing where everything's kind of surprising and yet perfectly aligned has become a staple of kind of artsy American indie editing. But at the time, for an American film, it wasn't necessarily new, but that brash use of it, especially ending the way that it does, it was exciting. And Mike Nichols, the director, would go out to rely on Sam Osteen, who edited almost all of his films throughout Nichols' career. He'd also work with Roman Polanski in the editing of Rosemary's Baby and Chinatown, which has some fantastic cuts, like this one.
Something black in the green part of your eye.
Oh, that. It's a flaw in the iris.
So much narrative information is left out, but the cut makes it obvious. It's a fantastic, one of my favorite cuts in 70s cinema. As I've talked about throughout this series, the directors of New Hollywood were influenced by the French New Wave and other non-American cinemas that were experimental before Hollywood caught on, but the editors were no different. Dede Allen, Sam Osteen, Marcia Lucas, Verna Fields, Bob Jones, and so many others were looking at classical Hollywood, but also France and Japan and India and elsewhere to get ideas. And one of the things that they played around with was Hollywood continuity editing. And I've talked a little bit about that, but just quickly as a refresher, Hollywood continuity editing is a kind of catch-all phrase that covers a lot of stuff. But the idea behind it is that the viewer is not supposed to notice the editing, right? So when a character walks into a room through a door, it's important when we cut that they're walking in the same direction. The first room they're in and the second room they're in might be in two different buildings, might be on the same soundstage but shot at different times, might have been shot in reverse order. Who knows? The important thing is that for the audience, as we're watching, oh yeah, he just walked into the room. We don't notice the edit, even though the edit might be huge in terms of geography or chronology. This is continuity editing. When I look at you, or when I look this way, and I'm saying, hey, John, how's it going? And we cut to John, it's important that John's looking this way. He's like, oh, it's going pretty well, right? So that there is an eyeline match between the two of us. So even though those two scenes might have been shot again at different times, you, the viewer, look at that and go, oh, there's two people talking, they're having a conversation. And there's a lot of rules that go into this that make it the editing appear invisible, supposedly, or seamless. Terms like that get used a lot. I find them a little bit problematic because they undermine the actual work that editors have done since, A Day in the Life of an American Fireman figured out we could cut from the fire engine up to the room and back down to the fire engine. And wow, we can have two locations going at the same time. Editors have to figure out how to do that. And these editors, though, in the 60s and into the 70s, started to push that, started to play with that. Even in situations where they used a kind of conventional editing style, they pushed that editing style in ways that were not standard. Other famous editing stories from the 70s are really worth looking at again because we often forget how powerful they are. One of the best stories comes from the film Jaws. And everybody knows the filming of Jaws seemed to be a big fiasco. It was getting reported in the press that this young director, this upstart, this whiz kid, Steven Spielberg, didn't know what he was doing and he was gonna fall apart. And there was this gleeful sort of shark smelling blood, to use an apt metaphor, that the Hollywood press gets sometimes when they sense a failure. And oftentimes they affect the outcome of the film. Something like Ishtar. Oftentimes they don't. Titanic. And of course, Jaws. And one of the problems on the set of Jaws was that the sharks just weren't working. They had these animatronic sharks and model sharks, and they just didn't look real. So Verna Fields, the editor of that film, famously suggested two things. One, let's not show the shark. Let's wait until the end. Let's let the audience imagine the shark. That's a classic horror approach, because what we can imagine as viewers is sometimes much scarier than what the screen will show us. But it wasn't the original plan going into Jaws. The other idea she had in mind is, let's cut to the shark's point of view. And let's look at how that works in a scene.
Are you okay?
Everything's fine.
Yeah, fine, fine.
Listen, if the kids go to the water, it's worrying you.
No.
And they can play out here on the beach.
All right, let them go.
It's cold. We know all about you, Chief. You don't go in the water at all, do you?
Some bad hat, Harry.
Chief Brody, you are uptight.
Yes.
Come on. That's it.
So you can see there, like, it's almost sort of silly to think that we might, as viewers, get into the shark's point of view, But in Jaws, it creates a massive amount of tension because we're cutting from the beach, we're cutting to the swimmer, we're cutting to the shark. We know what's coming, and it increases a sense of dread. And so much of that works because of the editing. We forget that's not a shark underwater. That's just a camera person pushing a camera through the water. That kid's not gonna get eaten by the shark, right? There's gonna be some fake blood spouting. And, you know, it's intensified by those cuts in front of Brody, you know, as we get closer to him, and then the famous dolly zoom that takes place once he realizes what's happened. But so much of how that scene works is down to Verna Fields' editing of it. I'm gonna put a link below to a video essay about Marcia Lucas's editing of Star Wars, in particular, the final assault on the Death Star and how she saved the film. And it's a fascinating look at what editing can do to shape narrative, to shape audience expectations, to actually completely change what happens in a film and how the viewer receives the film. And there are so many more editors that we could talk about that were doing magnificent work during this era. When you watch a film, and if you're into 70s films, when you watch a 70s film, think about how your expectations are being guided by the editing. Look up the film. Who was the editor of that film? What else did they work on? I think you'll be surprised to see, oh, she edited that, but she also edited that, Dog Day Afternoon. She also, Marcia Lucas edited Mean Streets, Star Wars, Mean Streets, American Graffiti. I mean, Marcia Lucas has her fingers on what you could call the three prototypical New Hollywood films. The low budget explosion of American Graffiti, the dark twisted fable of Taxi Driver, and the blockbuster to end all blockbusters, Star Wars. And there's Marcia Lucas guiding each one of those films in the editing room. Another crew member who was vastly influential in shaping the look of New Hollywood was the cinematographer. These were almost all men. Cinematography is the sort of final barrier to women's entry into sort of full participation in Hollywood filmmaking. And there are some great female cinematographers working today, but still, in the history of the Academy Awards, only one woman has ever been nominated for an award for cinematography. That was Rachel Morrison in 2017 for the film Mudbound. Anyway, in the 70s, these men, just like the editors who were experimenting with new ways of directing narrative and putting pieces of information together, these cinematographers were exploring what one could do with the visual. And as with the directors and the editors, they felt unchained from the Hollywood sort of dictates of the past. And oftentimes there are still some beautifully shot films that look sort of like classic Hollywood. Those rich, creamy colors and the darkness and the light of The Godfather's beautifully composed film shot by Gordon Willis, who experimented with light and dark in a lot of different ways. And I've talked about him before. And like him, a lot of the other cinematographers of the era were interested in capturing light, in capturing color, in capturing imagery in different ways. One of the earliest ways they did this was by allowing lens flares to appear in their films. And this was something that wouldn't have happened generally in classical Hollywood, because as you know, a lens flare is when light goes into the lens, and because of the angle it enters, it is refracted in different ways and it creates this kind of halo effect. And there's different types of them. It would have been representative of the artifice of filmmaking, because we don't see lens flares when we walk around the street and so on. And films like Cool Hand Luke, shot by the great Conrad Hall, started to allow for lens flares to exist on camera. But it's really considered to be Easy Rider, shot by the great Hungarian cinematographer Laszló Kovács, or Kovács. And it's beautiful, almost synchronous lens flares timed with the motorcycles and the music and the way they opened up a sort of vista of the American Southwest that really showed the lens flare not just as a captured mistake, a kind of Brechtian pushing of the fourth wall, but a thing of beauty in its own right. Cinematographers also experimented with color in interesting ways. For example, the other great Hungarian cinematographer of the era, Vilmos Zsigmond, would often flash the film, exposing it to small amounts of light, the negative, after shooting, particularly on films he shot with Robert Altman, like McCabe and Mrs. Miller or The Long Goodbye, to change the way the color saturation appeared on screen. It's a very risky move once you've got a film in the can to expose it to any amounts of light, but Zsigmond became an expert at it. Cinematographers who came up through the industrial system or through documentary filmmaking got very good at shooting gritty, on the street, slice of life, handheld, shaky camera kinds of films. Owen Roizman, who worked on a lot of the early films of William Friedkin, does that magnificently in The French Connection. Haskell Wexler, who worked with Norman Jewison and Hal Ashby and a host of other filmmakers, was also very practiced at this, and you can see his handheld excellence in Mike Nichols' Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, a sort of proto-New Hollywood film, in his own film Medium Cool, which I've done a video about, and in The Heat of the Night, which I've also done a video about. The cinematographers of the 70s also benefited from some really important technological developments, and there's too much of that to go into here. New lenses, new film stock, new ways of capturing color, but there's two I'd like to mention. One is the Panaflex, and one is the Steadicam. The Panaflex is actually a series of cameras developed by Panavision starting in 1972. And the goal of these cameras was to have a high quality 35 millimeter camera that was lightweight and as silent as possible. So a lot of the parts were removed and the camera was reconfigured, and they perfected it over time. But what that meant was that with that small camera without a blimp, you know, to muffle the sound, cameramen, cinematographers, could get into much tighter spaces than they'd previously been able to. And this brought an element of reality or realism to the films. I talked about that in the sort of what makes a new Hollywood film, new Hollywood film, is this attempt to capture realism. And now when you can get into tighter spaces, when you can show ceilings in small rooms, when you can sit in the back of a car, a real car, driving down the street and capture the sound live, that adds to this realism, and cinematographers were quick to jump on it. I showed you a scene before that I really love, that cut in Chinatown, but let's watch the early part of that scene again. So there they are in that bathroom, and it's those close-ups, and that's a Panavision that they're using to film that scene that allows them to get in there like that. And that's the work of the great 70s cinematographer John Alonzo. And Alonzo, one of the things that Alonzo was so good at was blending a sort of new approach to cinematography, like that scene, with something more grand in the old Hollywood tradition. He was fantastic at capturing the magic hour, which we see throughout Chinatown, but also in a film that maybe seems less serious, but is really good, The Bad News Bears. That's John Alonzo working there, and he did it again in Hal Ashby's Harold and Maude. So one of the great things about these cinematographers is that they understood the technology. They understood cameras, lenses, film, light. And what these filmmakers would do is take part in that experimentation and then at the same time capture these grand vistas reminiscent of old Hollywood. Steadicam is actually a brand name for a kind of camera stabilization unit. It's one of those brand names that we use to cover all such stabilization units, just like we use Kleenex to talk about tissues, or over where I live, Hoovers to talk about vacuum cleaners. The Steadicam is the sort of metonym for all camera stabilization units, even though there are other types. It was developed in the mid-70s by a guy named Garrett Brown, who's one of the unsung heroes of the last 40 years of Hollywood history. And it's basically a vest with a frame or a harness on it that's attached to an arm on which the camera can be placed. There's a sort of frictionless or near frictionless gimbal, right? A sort of stabilization unit. And what that means is that when the cameraman has a camera on the Steadicam harness, he can move the arm up and down, side to side, and move through space, forwards, backwards, turning, right? He can do all of those at once. He can move through space and turn the camera. He can move through space, turn, and lift the camera. All the while, because of the gimbal unit, the camera stays steady, right? So when you see a lot of handheld shots, which you see a lot of in the late 60s and early 70s, you get that shaky vibe. And that's something to be desired in sort of life on the streets, fight scenes. They came back big time in the early 2000s with like the Bourne Identity films. But the Steadicam allowed filmmakers to move through space without having to put down expensive and sort of potentially disruptive tracks, or to use a big sort of dolly unit on wheels. So now you can go over gravel, you can go up and down hills, up and down stairs, right? And you see that in the original reel that Garrett Brown made. And so he developed his Steadicam. He's like, I want to sell this to Hollywood. And he made a reel of him using the Steadicam in different situations that might appeal to Hollywood filmmakers. Does that look familiar? James Crave, the cinematographer, and John Avildsen, the director of Rocky, called on Brown to shoot the stair scene in Rocky, that famous stair scene, after seeing this reel. A lot of Hollywood filmmakers saw this reel and decided, I want that. The actual first use of the Steadicam in a film comes in 1976's Bound for Glory, the Hal Ashby film, shot by Haskell Wexler. And here it is. Notice how it starts as a crane shot and then how seamlessly the camera moves through the crowd. What I love about that scene is the collaborative nature of it. Ashby's directing a film. He's got a big budget for the first time in his career, and they're giving him the opportunity to make a film about one of his heroes, Woody Guthrie, and he's finally got the opportunity to work with his good friend Haskell Wexler, the cinematographer. They'd worked together back in the Norman Jewison days in the 60s, but Ashby hadn't been able to get Wexler on any of his previous four films. Finally, they're together, and they're going to shoot this film. They've got Carradine to play Woody Guthrie. And Wexler comes to Ashby one day and says, you know that Steadicam thing? I think we could use it. And Ashby's like, let's give it a shot, right? And they called up Garrett Brown, and he came. And Garrett Brown's actually operating the Steadicam in that scene. So you've got Ashby, the director, saying, let's do it. You've got Haskell, the cinematographer, saying, yeah, I want to do this. You've got Garrett Brown operating it. Actually, the sound guy, Jeff Wexler, is walking with the mic in his recording equipment down beneath them, recording the live sound the whole time. And of course, Carradine and all of those extras performances. It's an amazing accomplishment that hadn't been done before in film, and it would soon be replicated in Rocky, which came out the same year, The Marathon Man, which came out the same year, and probably most famously by the end of the decade in Stanley Kubrick's film The Shining, with cinematography by John Alcott. The important thing about the Panavision and the Steadicam was not just that they allowed filmmakers new approaches to shooting certain scenes, but they allowed filmmakers to reconceive of narrative, to reconceive of what you can do in geographical space. And that remakes cinema in a way. And they're not the only developments. Like I said, there was a lot more going on, particularly with film stocks in the 70s that changed the way films look too. But these two cameras were really important. And what's worth remembering is that in the case of both of them, it was really the cinematographers who pushed their use first. Production design is an area of filmmaking that is talked about very little. We recognize it, particularly when it calls attention to itself in a film like Blade Runner. Whoa, that's amazing. It looks so futuristic and real. But oftentimes, like editing, production design in Hollywood is meant not to call attention to itself. But while the editors and the cinematographers were incredibly important to the New Hollywood era, one could argue that the production designers, particularly a handful of them, were as responsible for the change of Hollywood cinema's look as anybody else. The drive for a new realism in Hollywood occurred for a lot of reasons, but it could happen because some of these production designers almost completely eschewed old Hollywood ways of doing things. And when you read interviews with production designers like Richard Silbert or Polly Platt or Dean Tavolaris, one of the things they say over and over again is, we didn't want that bright, that pink, that fake Hollywood look. We wanted it to look real. Polly Platt talks about how there's nothing she likes seeing more on screen than a character whose clothes don't fit them properly, right? Because that's real. And hand in hand with this went the propensity in New Hollywood for location shooting. There's a lot of reason why location shooting became important to New Hollywood. It was cheaper, and if you recall from a previous video, Hollywood in the late 60s and early 70s was still in the midst of a recession, so shooting off the lot meant saving money. It allowed these kind of maverick directors to get away from Hollywood, so if they wanted to do things that maybe the Suits or the Money Men wouldn't approve of, you know, this is long before the internet, they're very far away and those people can't quite have as much oversight. But also to bring this sense of realism. If the film is set in Texas, like Bonnie and Clyde, we're gonna shoot in Texas. If it's set in New York, like The French Connection, we're gonna shoot in New York. A lot of films had been shot in New York throughout Hollywood history, but it exploded in the 70s. If it's shot in Chicago, in Seattle, like The Parallax View, in San Francisco, like Harold and Maude or What's Up Doc, we're gonna go there and shoot it. And at the time, this explosion of location shooting was so kind of new. There wasn't generally a dedicated person, a location manager, to doing the work to find the places. And it was the production designer who did it. And often they were tasked with finding realistic looking spaces. So Dean Tavolaris talks about finding the places in Texas for Bonnie and Clyde that he had in his mind. Bonnie's bedroom and the opening scene is a real location. And Tavolaris talks about, I wanted to see the peeling wall paint. I wanted to see the ceilings. Now this caused a problem for Burnett Guffey because he's shooting with old school big lights, big cameras, and he had to get into these tight spaces, and he actually walked off the film for a day because it was too intense for him to shoot in this new way. But the film, I think, shows that interesting collaboration between old school Hollywood and this new approach to production design, and it's part one of the things that's exciting about it. But production designers do a lot. What they do is they read the script, they start to conceptualize a theme for the film. They start to conceptualize its kind of deeper meanings. And they allow that sense of what the script means to them to guide their production. On the last picture show, Polly Platt talks about how when she read the book and then read the script, what she took away from it was, this town wears people down. It breaks people down. I want to see this town falling apart. So they went to this town in Texas, Archer City, which is actually where the original novelist Larry McMurtry had grown up and based the novel on. And Archer City allowed Platt to go through a stretch of the town and remodel the fronts of buildings. So when you see the gas station, the Texaco, with letters missing from the sign, Platt took those letters off the sign. When you see the greasy window of the pool hall, well, that was already greasy. And when the production crew came in and said, oh, we'll clean up the windows, Platt's like, no, don't clean up the windows. This is part of the theme for her. This crumbling town that wears its inhabitants down is also wearing itself down. So you can see there's a combination there between the production design Let's take these letters off the sign. Let's shoot in a greasy, dirty pool hall. And the location, which Polly Platt was in charge of. Richard Silbert, the fantastic production designer on Chinatown, was also the location director for that film. He talks about how whenever we see Jake Giddies walking outside, I wanted to see him walking uphill. And he went and scouted Los Angeles for these hills that Giddies could have to walk up. For him, one of the themes of the film is no matter how hard Giddies works, no matter how hard the forces of right or goodness, even cynical goodness, work, defeating evil is always an uphill battle. So Silbert chose the locations based on that and then designed the film around that idea. And these production designers choose color. They choose props. Sometimes they choose costume, particularly in Platt's case. So everything you see on screen that's not a performer, in some cases their costume, and that's not light, the production designer put there. When auteurists talk about the mise-en-scene, Scorsese's mise-en-scene, Coppola's mise-en-scene, Altman's mise-en-scene, a lot of what they're talking about is the work of the production designer. And sometimes it's so detailed and yet so minute that you don't even notice it. Like there's a scene in The Last Picture Show when we go into JC's bedroom, and JC is the sort of town flirt. She's one of the town rich kids, and there's this dwindling class of oil moneyed rich people and the sort of growing working class and lower class community that is being torn down by Anne Arine or Archer City. And there's this fantastic scene between her and her mother in her room when her mother's trying to get her to dump Dwayne, played by a young Jeff Bridges, and JC Sybil Shepherd is like, oh, I love him and all this stuff. And in the background, in two quick scenes, we see that radio. And now that's really interesting because that's a new radio, probably late 40s model, 1950. And throughout the film, there are radios everywhere. The film's kind of famous for having only source music or diegetic music. All the music we hear in The Last Picture Show is being played on a radio or a record player or elsewhere. And most of the other radios that we see are worn down, beaten up, static. So there's the radio in Sonny's truck that barely seems to work and looks like it's about to fall off. There's the radio in Sam's pool hall that's staticky. Even the jukebox in the diner, and there's a funny line there where Genevieve says, you know, save the jukebox for someone who can afford it. And that line is very interesting because what that line does is it ties the idea of music and accessibility of music to the town's social class, and then cut to JC's room, and there in these two brief shots is this expensive tabletop model of a radio. That's production design. And it's the kind of thing that, like I said, is meant to be invisible. You don't notice the radio. You may have seen this film 3 or 5 or 10 times and not ever paid attention to the radio. And there it is, white, pristine, expensive. It's a marker that tells us something about JC. And it tells us in a way that no matter how much she flirts with Dwayne or Sonny, that's not the way she's gonna go in the end. There's so much more that I could say about not just cinematography, editing, and production design, but sound design. The whole development of Dolby and the Dolby system, Dolby's clear audio system, and then Dolby Stereo, how Star Wars got cinemas around the country and around the world, really, to install Dolby Stereo systems in their theaters, which affected sound design and the way the role of the sound designer growing, special effects and the growing use of special effects and how they changed cinema and really led us in a lot of ways to where we are today. There's so much more to talk about, but when we think of 70s films, we can't just think that they're made by directors in a vacuum. It's not just that Gordon Willis and John Alonzo or Dede Allen and Walter Murch, who I didn't even mention, Bob Jones, Verna Field, Marcia Lucas, or Polly Platt, or Dean Tavalaris. It's not just that these 5 or 8 or 12 people were good at their job. They made those decisions. They put those things in front of the camera, or lit those things and shot them, or made the cutting decisions later on. So that the film we watch, it might have begun as a vision of the director or the writer, and there's a whole other video I could make about the fantastic writers, Carol Eastman, Robert Towne, and so on of this era. But it's not realized without the work of production designers, cinematographers, and editors. I'm going to put a list below of several of the cinematographers and more, same with editors, the ones I mentioned and more, and production designers, if you want to check out the work of these other great crew members. I call them filmmakers of the era. Thanks so much for watching, everybody. Who's your favorite cinematographer of the 70s? I'd love to hear what you think about it in the comments below. What's your favorite piece of editing in a new Hollywood film? Have you ever thought about production design? What's a film from the 70s that you love the look of? Drop a comment below and please hit a like button, hit a subscribe button. It helps my channel and it also just lets me know that you're out there. Until next time, I'm Aaron Hunter. Keep watching movies.